Chairman Brown, Ranking Member Toomey, and members of the committee, thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak today. In these last 14 months have been an incredibly challenging time as the pandemic has swept across the world, killing almost 600,000 Americans and plunging us into a steep economic retraction. Even today, our hearts go out to the people of India and others around the world who continue to suffer from this virus. However, because of the swift actions taken by Congress, the Federal Reserve, and others to combat this health and economic crisis, I'm very optimistic about our future. As more people are vaccinated, the U.S. is poised for a strong recovery. And I'd be remiss if I didn't thank Moderna, Pfizer, Johnson & Johnson, and AstraZeneca for the amazing work they've done on life-saving vaccines. The banking industry performed well during the crisis, as the Fed's two stress tests in 2020 confirmed. This is due in part to the Dodd-Frank Act and other financial regulations put in place since the 2008 crisis. Goldman Sachs remained well capitalized, both leading up to and throughout the pandemic. Goldman Sachs has more than 40,000 employees, and I continue to be in awe of their resilience. To help them through the pandemic, we gave our people an additional 10 days of paid family leave, expanded access to child and adult care, offered free telemedicine, and rolled out a global COVID testing regime. In addition, we've continued to pay our on-site vendor staff, whether they worked or not. That includes our mailroom staff, cafeteria workers, security guards, and janitorial staff. Over the last year, we experienced historically elevated levels of client demand. And because we were well capitalized, we were able to help our corporate clients weather the impact of COVID-19 and position themselves for a post-pandemic recovery. For our digital bank customers, we launched a COVID customer assistance program, which allowed customers to defer loan payments for 4 months and credit card payments for 6 months at no extra cost. We also found innovative ways to support small businesses. We are not an SBA lender, so we did not participate directly in the Paycheck Protection Program. Instead, we committed $1.25 billion in capital to community development financial institutions and mission-driven lenders who facilitated PPP loans across the country. The capital we deployed with our CDFI partners reached very small businesses, nearly half of which are in minority communities. The average loan size is around 43,000, and the median employee count is 2. In addition, last week, we committed another $1 billion in partnership with the SBA and our CDFI partner, Lendistry, to fund approximately 40,000 PPP loans, over half of which will benefit minority-owned businesses. We did this to ensure these applicants were able to have their loans processed and approved before the PPP funds are exhausted. We also continue to support small businesses through our 10,000 Small Business Program, launched in 2010. Through this program, we provide education by partnering with community colleges and greater access to capital to thousands of small businesses. Last year, we committed an additional $250 million to serve another 10,000 small business owners. We've also committed an additional $500 million to our program for diverse entrepreneurs and investors, launched with GS. And now I want to focus on three other initiatives that are incredibly important to us. First, we've already achieved more than a fifth of our 10-year target of $750 billion in financing, investing, and advisory activity focused on climate transition and inclusive growth. We've been carbon neutral across our own operations since 2015, and we recently set a goal of net zero carbon emissions in our supply chain by 2030. Second, we commissioned extensive research on how to mitigate income inequality, which showed that Black women are one of the most marginalized groups in this country. It found that if we can reduce the earnings gap for Black women, we could see U.S. GDP increase by $300 billion a year. In response, we developed a new initiative called 1 Million Black Women, where we will invest $10 billion over the next 10 years to narrow opportunity gaps for at least 1 million Black women in the U.S. The final initiative relates to improving our diversity and inclusion. When I became CEO 2.5 years ago, I said this would be one of my top priorities. Since I last testified before Congress, we have made progress. Our board will now have 6 out of 13 directors who are women and will be 62% diverse by race, gender, or sexual orientation. Our newest partner class includes the highest percentage of women and Black partners in our history. In addition, our 2020 campus analyst class in the Americas was 55% women and Black talent, our highest ever. However, I'm not satisfied with this, and we continue to work to address this.
Shepard Smith here. Thanks for watching CNBC on YouTube.